Hi, Matt.
Hi, Ann. How's it going?
Well, it's a little crazy here in Madison, Wisconsin. It's like night out there, and there's rumbling thunderstorms, and we had tornado warning last night, and lots of crazy hail and so on, so I'm a little, I'm glancing over at my window here, and it's kind of green out there, which is kind of a tornado color, kind of gets green before a tornado.
So there's some chance we could see, like, the destruction of your home by a tornado.
Well, yeah, it could be
quasi-live on internet video.
Or it could just all go black with the electricity going out. So
right, maybe, yeah. Well, okay, well, that would be unfortunate.
Okay, so that's...
There's no battery backups. And,
No. So this could all be for naught, but hopefully it will be for something. Okay?
Right, yeah. All I'm doing is getting ready to move, which is boring.
Oh, yeah? So are you have all kinds of boxes and exciting
yeah,
stuff?
Yeah, I've been, like, slowly but surely packing.
So now where are you moving to and from?
Just, like, a couple blocks.
Oh, you're just moving a couple blocks?
Yeah, it's really, it's profoundly uninteresting and really sort of unfun.
But are you in Washington? What city are you in?
Washington, D.C.
Okay, so you feel like you're all in the thick of things there, whereas I always feel like I'm holed up in this outpost in the Midwest where no one can... People can get mad at me, but they can't hurt me.
Right. Well, and you have that crucial outside the beltway perspective.
Yeah.
It's important.
Yeah.
And a recent op-ed in the New York Times.
Oh, yeah. Well, so, yeah, I thought we would start with that, okay?
right.
Although, you know, I don't want to be the law, you know, the law students are coming back soon, and I'm thinking, you know, this doesn't have to be law professory.
Sure.
I thought the way I would, so that you could, you know, I don't want to just hold forth on the topic. I'm feeling a little besieged and so on. But, you know,
fair enough.
You have to expect if you read an op-ed in the New York Times about, you know, the hot case that people are very keen on protecting or whatever. But I think that the big thing that happened in this case, which is ACLU v. NSA, was that the
And this was about the surveillance without warrants of international phone calls.
Yes. And the judge enjoined all of that. She left the data mining part of the program alone, but there's another part of the program that just was called TSP in the opinion, which apparently stands for the, not the secret program, but the, I'm not sure what it stands for. It was a little unclear.
Okay. It's a mystery acronym.
But so, I mean, part of the problem is we don't know exactly what it is, but we're being told that it's unconstitutional, and then there are questions about the reporters who are bringing the lawsuit, whether they're proper parties and so on. But I guess what I thought would be interesting to talk about would be... the way after there was a New York Times editorial that was just praising the article and treating it, the case and treating it as if it was you know, really scholarly, really well argued, what you would sort of picture in an idealized opinion, and it kind of starts out that way as it hits like the first couple of issues, but then it, in my view, and I think a lot of people agree with me, it just sort of changes midway through and becomes just sort of like a rough outline of things and. Just kind of a shockingly flawed or minimal discussion of all of these incredibly important issues. And I just find it very hard that the decision came out in that form. And, go on.
I found it was the kind of thing where, you know, a lot of people, lay people who, you know, approve of the outcome, sort of, you know, like the opinion, because it's written in its later sections in a very, rhetorical style, you know, which is accessible, but that actual, you know, people who, lawyers and people who look at these things, professionally, you know, felt that it was odd and was not making, really proper arguments.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I know a blogger I read named Scott Lemieux who, you know, studies law and even, I guess like me, tends to take the view that, you know, that the substantive outcomes are primarily what's important in these things.
Yeah.
That even so, that when a lower court judge puts together a sloppy opinion, I mean, all that happens is it's going to wind up getting reversed.
It could be upheld on some other ground, but it doesn't make, I mean, a well-written initial opinion is sort of like an argument to the, I think Eugene Volokh wrote something like this on his blog, that it works as sort of a persuasive argument to the appellate court, and it lays a lot of groundwork. It's like a reliable brief that the appellate court is going to take very seriously. But if it's written in a sketchy, bad way that contains misstatements and is obviously minimal, that opportunity is missed. So really the people who like the outcome, it seems to me, ought to be unhappy to see the outcome come out in that form, especially since, you know, the critics of the case are going to say, well, it's an activist judge. She's just doing what she wants. She's just picking the outcome she wants.
And if you don't put the best possible case forward,
yeah.
You know, it implies that you don't have a better
Right. So, what I was saying is it's counterproductive because if there are good arguments and you don't make them, it's going to make people think that there aren't good arguments. So you're actually undercutting your own case. And even more fundamentally than that, you're kind of giving, you're reinforcing this impression that a lot of people have that the judge is just pursuing an outcome, is just result-oriented. And I mean, normally when we say that, we at least have an opinion that's detailed enough that it makes people say, well, first they pick the outcome and then they put in all of this legalistic reasoning to try to cover up that that's all they did. So it really shocks me when a judge comes out with an opinion that's going to attract a lot of criticism of people saying this is just result-oriented and then doesn't even layer in all of that discussion that you would think that they would put up to protect themselves from that criticism.
But still, I mean, while I'm not a lawyer, obviously, and I do understand that the standing question is fairly complicated. One of my colleagues here, I believe, is one of the journalistic parties to the suit, and I think there's various questions you could raise about that. The basic question here seems reasonably clear cut to me. I mean, I know some people don't take this view, but the argument that an authorization for the use of military force against Afghanistan somehow repeals the Intelligence Surveillance Acts that were, you know, passed previously and amended in light of 9/11 and so forth, you know, always struck me as something that doesn't pass the lab test.
Well, I agree.
I mean,
that's
not something I would write, you know, in a judicial opinion.
Well, I think that might be the weakest of the arguments, but there's more to it than just that. There's also the idea that the president might have the inherent power with respect to defending the country, with respect to communications from the enemy or to the enemy during wartime, that really actually is something that's reserved exclusively to the president. Even if you don't like that argument, in order to reject it, you got to take it seriously and write deeply about it, I think.
To convince
people that you're doing it out of law. Because if you're not doing it out of law, why do we want to listen to you at all? You know?
Right. No, I mean, I guess that's clear.
Larry Tribe, Harvard Law professor, did a blog post and wrote to the New York Times on the subject of saying, you know, don't criticize the judge's opinion. It's the right outcome, and it's important to support it. So you're just distracting people. You know, you really ought to just get behind the outcome, and you know, don't call attention to that man behind the curtain or something.
Sure. Well, you know, I mean, I do sympathize with what he's trying to say there. I mean, obviously, it puts everyone who agrees with the outcome in an awkward position for the judge to have written something which is not so hot, and presumably now it's going to, you know, it'll get reversed, this will be kicked back down, there's going to be more litigation about it going on for quite some time, I would think, will be the...
And possibly more legislation that'll affect the outcome.
Right.
Because, you know, obviously they're working on some legislation. I mean, some of what was really bad about the opinion was reaching out for constitutional questions like Fourth Amendment and First Amendment, rather than the statutory stuff that you were just talking about, where the path to the outcome is clearer. But if you do it on the statutes, Congress could change the statute, and then, you know, you've lost your outcome.
Yes, right. And there's probably going to be legislation on that. Yeah. It looks like. Should we move on?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, I was going to say, apropos of result-oriented decisions, it seems I want to talk about science and result-oriented decisions. I sometimes people will say that about various issues like global warming or something like that. But it seems to me the scientists have the things that they want to be true too, and they also have to worry about what we think of them, and they should be purely scientists. But I thought this this little farce with respect to Pluto this week was a really egregious example of scientists.
Well, although they've given up today.
There was
this struggle to come up with a definition of planet which would keep it so that Pluto was a planet.
But they were motivated to keep it as a planet because they thought that's what we wanted. Right.
And frankly, it is what I want. And I'm a little upset that they've gotten rid of it.
Well, why is there this affection for Pluto? Is it just because it's the name of Mickey Mouse's dog?
It's how I was, we were all in school. We were all taught that there were 9 planets, that Pluto was one of them. I think I learned some kind of mnemonic device, mm-hmm. To remember which ones they were. And I even learned the there's like a wacky trivia fact about how most of the time Pluto is further away than Neptune, but sometimes it's closer.
Well, didn't that screw up the mnemonic device?
Yes, right, it does. But I mean, the bulk of my meager knowledge of astronomy is tied up with the idea that Pluto is a planet. And,
you learn about it when you're a kid, and it's small, and it's far away, so do you sort of sympathize with it? Do you identify with it?
Well, I don't know. But also, I mean, we're going to what? Like, schools everywhere are going to have to order new textbooks or, post-it notes everywhere saying, no, Pluto, it's not really a planet. And why? So these busybody scientists can have a more rigorous definition? I mean, what's the difference?
Well, I worry about the... not a tornado. I'll just worry about Pluto, which is much farther away.
Sure.
This crazy weather is scaring me. I'm worried that I was about to hear the siren. So it seems to me that first they thought we loved the planet, so they tried to come up with a definition that was all based on keeping it as a planet.
Right.
And then they brought in these extra 2 or 3 planets.
Right.
Because
Charon.
One was named Xena.
The far Earth orbital object, Xena.
And they're supposed to be named after Roman gods. So the ones that aren't named after Roman gods, I didn't like them coming in. It was all...
Right, well, but you can rename them. The way the naming convention was supposed to go is that I think, if it got promoted, mm-hmm. then it came in. Because one of the potential candidates, it was called just something like UB-313,
right.
I think, because it wasn't a planet, but it's actually bigger than Pluto, so there was some chance that it would get planet status, and then it got to have a classical name.
But now it seemed to me that when people mocked them for just making up a rule that would keep Pluto as a planet, that then they remit. And they changed it. It was sort of, it reminded me of Bill Clinton or something like that. It's sort of like, well, let's take a poll and see what people think, and we'll just change the policy if they don't like it. So
that
made me feel bad about scientists.
But to make a semi-serious astronomical point here, right, the concept of a planet actually, it played an important role in pre-Copernican astronomy, but... In the Copernican system, the question of what's a planet and what isn't doesn't relate to the actual scientific work that scientists do. And this, the AP story on this, you've been observed that this, now that they have the new ruling where there's going to be only 8 planets, will be the first time since Copernicus that we've had a firm definition of planet. But obviously, the science was proceeding just fine.
So you're saying that the categories and the labeling had no scientific significance anyway.
Right. I mean, because it's not a natural kind, right? I mean, you classify different astronomical bodies according to what they're composed of.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So
they weren't
changing any of the facts about Pluto. They were just
It's just that it's a purely informal category, right? It's mm-hmm. it's not like a bona fide scientific term. Just like panda, right? People say panda, and that encompasses the giant pandas and the red pandas. But those two animals aren't actually related; they just kind of look the same. So people call them the same thing, but scientists don't use the word that way. And it never should have become this big brouhaha.
Well, I'm glad it's out. Well, what do you think that today yesterday it came out about the new stem cell? A way of extracting stem cells from embryos that don't kill the embryos?
This is more consequential, I guess.
I mean, this has more to do, to get out of science and back into politics, it has more to do with, how the issue is played. I mean, obviously a lot of politics was done around stem cell research.
Right. I mean, it's a good wedge issue, I guess, for the Democrats, because the idea is that the most committed pro-life people, won't count in stem cell research, but federal funding for embryonic stem cell research was very popular, so that it was kind of like, it's like very late-term abortions.
And you can do some, here in Wisconsin, Governor Doyle, who's a Democrat, has really been you know, not only using the stem cell issue, but he has like a special task force of people who are specifically on that issue, and he has an ad, and of course the ad shows like a little girl or with cancer or something like that, and you show these sympathetic, you know, you always try to show sympathetic people in political ads, but this would be, you know, sick children and so forth. And
sick children are sick.
That was a big part of how Jim Doyle was opposing the Republican candidate, Mark Green. And I'm just interested to see if the new research will change what they say, or they'll just try to figure out a way to keep the issue alive because it was working for them.
Well, so, I mean, what I remember when I read the initial coverage was that, right, this new breakthrough, it might create a way to do the research without destroying embryos. Then what I didn't see was whether, pro-life people were actually embracing that conclusion, that this new technology,
right,
they would have no
problem
with.
Well, see,
I think
both sides could try to keep the issue alive by saying that doesn't change it. Or both sides could say, all right, now we can agree, right?
Right.
And I'm interested to see, will they both try to keep the issue alive? Will they both say, let's agree, or will one want to keep it alive, and the other will say, let's agree, and I know what do you think's going to be.
You know, I mean, I assume if it can be done with any level of plausibility, Democrats would like to keep this
alive.
So,
but if they want to keep it alive, they can say, if they want to keep it alive, all they have to do is say, well, the research isn't good enough yet, it doesn't show.
Right, I mean, you'd want to make the argument that, you know, all the options should be open, that it's not clear how well this works, and I don't know exactly what the new development was.
In order to do some kind of genetic testing before they implant the embryo, they need to take a cell out of this little group of cells that is starting the being or whatever. And so then when they get the one cell out, they do something with it to get that. They wait for that cell to divide, and then they take the one cell after they've divided to do the genetic testing that was going to be done anyway, and then the other one is the bonus cell that gets to be for the research.
Ah.
So it was a cell they were going to extract anyway, and after it's out, then they get it to reproduce, and then they have two cells.
But so that sounds like a kind of cloning that religious conservatives would object to.
Well, you see, you're giving them ideas. It's sort of like, if you want to keep working this issue, say that it's cloning.
Right. Sounds like it is to me. I mean, I welcome our.
Well, then why did they allow taking the first cell out? Maybe they shouldn't be doing that either.
Well, but you're just taking the cell out, right, and then running a scan. You're not, like, creating.
Yeah, I think they're trying to get around it. I'm just interested to see whether this will have any effect on the various, political races, like, especially here with our governor's race, because the main thing Doyle's been aiming at Green is this issue, trying to, you know, pigeonhole him as a big social conservative so that Wisconsinites won't go.
Well, he is, in fact, a big social conservative, though, right?
Well, I don't know. I don't know if he is or not, but that's very effective.
Right. Yeah, well, no, I mean, it could diffuse the issue. This is, I guess, part of the problem with structuring too much of your political strategy around scientific research is that there's, you know, sort of no telling what's going to happen with that, right? It's not really under your control.
And I just worry about science when it's used so much in politics. It sort of becomes, you know, what science is ends up being something that political people want it to be, and then maybe the scientists are political beings too, so they help
out. Well, you know, I mean, it's always been tied in, I don't know, airplanes.
Okay, well then let's just go on to the next topic. Well, we'll leave that one to fester or maybe divide and form a gang or something like that, and we'll get back to it some other week. I was going to ask you about these this airline passenger mutiny. I don't know if it's right to call
it. They refused to fly.
People just decided, I don't want to be on the flight with those with two men who looked to them like terrorists. It seemed to be that people were sort of kind of making up their own racial profiling.
But by look to them like terrorists, what they mean is look like Pakistanis. Right, I mean, it's not that, like, they were carrying bombs. They were...
Well, they said they were scruffy and they had long hair. And they looked at their watches a lot. There were some other factors.
But these are people who they were waiting for a plane to take off. And they were...
Yeah. But there must be South Asian people on all kinds of flights. So why did this start happening flight? I mean, it can't be just pure race, because if it was, this kind of thing
it's
would
obviously
happen
much
not more often.
Pure racism, because you can't go around, you know, England these days without seeing a South Asian somewhere, and this kind of freak out isn't happening all the time. But I mean, I think it's pretty obvious that at its core, this was just racism rather than any, you know, particular specific thing. And I have to say, I mean, I think this is pretty much the worst possible thing that could happen for the West as we deal with terrorism, would be for domestic Muslim populations in the United States, in England, in France, to be targeted en masse for this sort of massive discrimination. I mean, that is what's going to create an completely unmanageable terrorism problem, is that cycle of resentment. And I think it's pretty ridiculous that the airline gave in to these people's demands. And
well, what would you do? Imprison the people on the plane? If people want to get off the plane, you have to let them off.
Right, but
if people say,
but that's not what they
did. What would you
did. Do? They kicked the Asians off the plane. I mean, sure.
Well, they said, I'm not going to fly on that plane as long as
those guys. But so if the complaining racist passengers want to get off the plane, fine. My understanding was that they kicked the alleged terrorists off the plane, even though there was no evidence that they were terrorists.
I'm not sure if they did. They ask them, or did they?
Well,
just,
I don't know if they, you know, asked them or pressured them or whatever. But you know, I mean, that's crazy, right? I mean, if some people got on a bus or whatever in the United States and started talking about how they didn't want to ride with a black person, you know, I guess the driver would let the guy off the bus, but he certainly wouldn't kick the black people off it.
Yeah, it's like blaming the victim, or like stopping the speaker because it's making the people in the crowd.
Right. I mean, exactly. And it also, and it shifts the dynamic, right, from the perspective of the people who got kicked off the flight, from a day where they encountered, you know, a handful of jerks who wanted to get them off the plane, to a day in which, you know, the whole sort of system, including a major airline, the pilot, you know, people in positions of authority decided that they wanted to do that. And it's different, I would think, to, you know, experience some kind of racism or hostility from some people, and to experience, you know, the system really coming down against you.
Yeah. It hasn't, but the people did get their way, and yet it doesn't seem to be happening again. Or maybe little things like this happen all the time, and they're just not telling us because they are not
right. Well, I mean, I don't know where it's going to go, and I'll say, I mean, I will say, you know, one of the rare, really praiseworthy things that I think the Bush administration, or Bush personally, you know, has done over the past few years, is that right after September 11, he made a very, a large personal effort to try and, like, calm the situation down vis-a-vis American Muslims.
And rejected racial profiling.
Right, and just, you know, he, like, went to some mosques, brought some guys up on stage with him, and that was all good. And more recently, though, he's decided to sort of embrace the term Islamic fascism, which I know is something that, you know, had been popular with conservative bloggers and pundits and so forth, but that American Muslims find very offensive.
What good is that supposed to do?
And seems to show, I don't know, as his political position is weakening, you know, it seems to me that they've decided that they no longer want to put capital into that kind of thing. Which is too bad, because it's important, and they had it right the first time.
Yeah, well, some people were saying, I know I did a blog post about the passenger mutiny, and some of the people who were commenting were saying things like, well, this is what happens when the government refuses to racially profile, and the government should just be doing this, and then people wouldn't have to take
it into their own. That was Glenn Reynolds'
take. I'm not endorsing that. I'm just saying it. Yeah, so maybe something like that might have been, I don't know if he was necessarily advocating racial profiling so much as just that the official security has to be confidence-inspiring. And if people lose their confidence, then they're going to start thinking, you know, I need to be careful. And, they do tell us that we should look around and be in touch with our sort of instinctive feelings of when we're in danger.
This is a slightly crazy campaign on the DC Metro where it says terrorism is the enemy, complacency is the threat.
And don't we hear announcements even in airlines that if you're uncomfortable about something or if you think there's something wrong, you should report it? I mean, I think we've been encouraged to sort of be in touch with our animal instincts there and to notice when we feel threatened. And obviously there's an overlap between that feeling and just sort of retrograde racism. And so if you tell people to go with their instincts, some of their instincts are going to end up channeling the kind of racism that consciously we know we shouldn't have and we normally don't even think we have. But if we're just saying, who scares us?
There's something to that. Although, I don't see how officially endorsed, public sector ethnic profiling would reduce that. Right? I mean, theory...
Right. It would just create, other people would feel threatened by things, and it would create hostilities.
Right. I think what Reynolds wrote, though, was that, this is what happens when people don't have confidence in the security system, which seems plausibly enough. But then he attributed that to excessive political correctness on the part of the authorities. And, I don't really see that. Among other things, right, there haven't been attacks where it's even seemed like, well, the attack succeeded, but it could have been foiled if there had been more racial profiling, unless it had been really extreme,
unless the rule was like
Arabs aren't allowed to go to flight school.
But there was some stuff. There was someone on 9/11. Wasn't one of the security people on 9/11 identified Mohammed Atta or maybe a couple of them? And wanted to do something, and then that was, or is that just a...
Well, there were things where a couple of those guys had been tagged by FBI agents as suspicious. That's just my point, though, is that the people were, in fact, tagged as suspicious, absent the racial profiling dynamic. The problem was that... counterterrorism was obviously a relatively lower priority then than it is now. Yeah. And so these memos were sort of flying around, but nobody did anything.
Yeah. There was an article in the New York Times this past week about facial profiling, about getting very good at recognizing different kinds of emotions based on faces, and that the security people should be looking at people's faces and detecting the bombers by how they're...
I'd be thrilled.
Well, this is another sort of scientific topic. Is there a science of facial expression that people could learn, like a language that they could learn, and then they could find the... the liars, right? Like, they ask you those questions, did you keep your suitcase, and did you pack your own suitcase? And everybody knows how they're supposed to answer the questions, so why would a terrorist ever be selected? It must be that they're looking to see that you're lying.
Apparently on El Al, they do something along the lines of the question asking, but they ask more questions and do it like more seriously, and they believe that they can tell based on how you react.
I think they think the
terrorists are going to confess, but that they think they'll be able to find something out. And Israel, I don't know. They seem to have reasonably secure airlines.
It makes me think of the whole Lebanon war. There's this sort of legend of Israel that they do things so well, we assume that they're running El Al in some special, better than everyone else way, that they know how to do all sorts of things. And we should be doing that too.
It could just be that anti-Israeli terrorists are not particularly interested in blowing up Hell airplanes. Terrorists seem they're like a little eccentric in terms of which kinds of targets they think they want to hit.
Well, they seem very interested in planes.
Yes. Well,
they seem to have a special there's like our own fear of planes. I was going to bring up the movie Snakes on a Plane. Now this gives me my opportunity. There's a special fear of something bad going on.
Because people find the idea of planes scary.
Your nightmares and your Yeah, and the idea of dying in a plane, I mean, people can contemplate mm-hmm. dying a lot of ways, and dying in a plane crash is one that just stimulates some
yes,
primal fear.
Yes, and I find this scene very uncomfortable. So, you know, but.
But I also want to ask you about this new Survivor. I don't know if I want to give them
sure.
any publicity,
Survivor.
As much publicity as this might be, but the new season of Survivor. I haven't watched Survivor since the first season. I stopped watching when there was like a competition of trying to stand on a stunt.
Right, yes. No, I haven't seen it either for a couple seasons.
I didn't get it.
And
I just didn't think that was interesting. They're like, how long
right.
can you stand
well,
on
so
a stunt?
Well, so they're trying to bring people more interest by dividing the teams up by race.
By race.
Yes.
So, yeah, that's the... I've seen a season of The Apprentice where they divided the people by
right.
sex. But
yeah, so they're actually going to do this? Because, I mean, that just seems shocking
14,
to me
yes,
that
yes.
you could do that in contemporary America.
Yeah. I know. Well, so, I mean, it is a pretty good publicity stunt since people are going to talk about that. And but once the show starts, like, there's an Asian team, a Hispanic team, a
right.
black team, and a white team. And so then once they start doing competitions, isn't that going to, it just invites, inevitably, discussion about which groups
right,
are better.
Right, I mean,
better,
is there
going to
be a lot of, like, awesome stereotyping
how can you not
about,
talk
the,
about
the black
that?
Team is faster,
yeah.
and the Asian team does more math,
yeah.
and we...
I think as soon as you hear what the competition is, won't you start saying, well, that's going to help this, or it's going to hurt that team? I mean... If it's wrong to think like that,
yeah,
then,
I mean it seems
are they
bad.
I mean,
you know, I mean, it's sometimes frustrating, but I mean, we have a lot of taboos around race in this country for some pretty mm-hmm. sound reasons, historically speaking,
mm-hmm.
and you know, drumming up extra interest in a reality television show seems like a fairly
yeah.
trivial reason to be
it's
to be pushing those
way.
Boundaries.
Well, maybe they think that they're going to do it in such a good way that it'll actually be helpful to get us to pass these sort of taboos, and it'll
it's
actually
hard
have a good
to see
effect.
How that happen.
Yeah, I'm sure they're
right,
doing it
right,
for themselves,
yes.
but and of course the people who agreed to be on the show agreed
sure,
to do
but,
it
I
that
mean,
way. But I think
I mean,
that's
the people
enough.
Who, the people who agree to be on reality shows
played.
Are seriously mentally disturbed. I think,
they'll do anything.
Right? I mean,
yes. And even in that one in particular, they go on to physically
yes,
suffer for
no,
a long time.
It's bad. But there's some kind of prize, right?
I think, yeah. Is
yeah,
because,
I mean, some of these shows, there's no
like
prize. You just do it, you know, to be on TV.
The prize
when people
is
could just
TV,
buy, you know, webcams
online.
And post, you know, blogging heads clips.
Right, that's right. We're on TV. We're on TV.
TV of a sort, yeah.
Give us
I mean, and that's just great, you know.
Well, I just went out to get my lunch uh-huh. here before this, and I just bought a taco at or a burrito at
uh-huh.
Chipotle, and like they put a sticker on mine, and then they got all excited that I had won some kind of a prize. It turned out I like won 4 burritos that I can get on another occasion if I fax
yes.
in my order.
Chipotle
beforehand.
Chipotle plays games like that with you.
Yeah, and they were so excited. Like, I'm like, oh, please, I'm just trying to get back to my office. Let me out of here. And they're, like, explaining how the prize works. And I'm thinking, you know, the person before me would have been way
happier. Yeah, but, you know, I mean, if you eat enough burritos, then what's the problem?
Yeah, but you have to get 4 at once. Am I going to get, I mean, I have to, like, round up other people that are interested
some,
in burritos.
Some, like, some favorite
so.
Students?
Yeah, maybe I could, like, hint, maybe on the first day of class, like, I could ask a hard question. If somebody answers it, I could give them,
I guess this is the
know,
problem
burritos.
With the academic workplace is that you don't have, like, just coworkers who you go out with.
Prizes.
All the time.
No, we do have coworkers. We don't hate
right,
each other.
Right.
We do go out.
But, I mean, it's not quite the same dynamic, right? I mean, it's a sort of individual tasks you're doing. No.
We're friends with each other. We do things just for fun.
Right.
We do go out for lunch. Anyway, oh, but speaking of eating and speaking
sure.
of planes, okay, I've got the segue. I wanted to talk about this horrible Mark John Carr character who has confessed or seemingly something to the being involved with the murder of
Jaminet
yes. Ramsey. And just, we saw him on the coming back from Thailand on a plane over the weekend, and there were like, the news reports were following it like, it was like, O.J. Simpson's white Bronco or something like that. Is it, where's the plane? The plane is over
yes.
whatever part of the Pacific. And then there were, like, news reports about what he was eating. And then there was like a whole discussion of whether he should have had that to eat because he was given the business class meal and he got to get champagne and he had pâté or, and, you know, some sort of fancy prawns mm-hmm. and stuff like that. So my question there is something like, what do we think of this media frenzy? But there's also a question of what do we think the police were trying to sort of feed him fancy food to get him to lure him?
It's weird, you know. I mean, I don't understand exactly why this case has drummed up so much interest. I mean, you know, like everybody else, I was completely positive that the Ramsey parents were responsible here somehow.
Right.
I don't even remember why it is I thought that. You know, I mean, that's like the way these things go. It was a big story, you know, a while back, and I reached that conclusion based on cable news coverage, and then I didn't think about it again, and then I heard this other guy. Looks like maybe he did it. And I don't know what to think. I mean, it goes to show, basically, the cable news is terrible.
So some of it is our own feeling of being troubled that we bought the idea that the parents did it, that we were so willing to believe it, that if this other person really did it, then we feel bad about ourselves
yes.
that we were assuming all along that they did. Right. Am I losing you? Oh. Oh, no. Oh, no. Hi, Matt, again. Hi, Matt, again.
Hey,
we had a little
good to have you back.
Problem here.
Yes.
I don't know what that was.
Hopefully this will see the light of day at some point.
Somehow they know how to connect the... I might be having a little technical problem here. Am I losing you?
No.
Okay.
I can still hear you.
I'm all worried about technical things. Anyway, I guess I was saying that with respect to Mark John Carr, finding out that he'd confessed, that it kind of raises a question for us about whether we were bad people to have been so willing to think the parents
did. Right. But, I mean, I think what it really shows is just what most things in life show, which is that the people who are responsible for cable television news are basically evil. And you know, I can't even remember how it is they made me think that the parents were responsible or why it is
they
subjected us to all this coverage.
I mean, if you have a wife and she turns up dead, you will be the main suspect, right?
Right.
So then people are so sure the husband did it that they don't look for anybody else.
Right. But I mean, you know how just very arbitrarily the cable news producers just decide that, you know, crime X or crime Y is going to be this big story. And they, like, leap to all kinds of conclusions and give it this...
Yeah.
Just a volume of coverage that totally outstrips
well,
the actual information.
Why do they pick the ones they pick? I mean, this one was clearly one to pick because it got everybody excited in it about it. I mean, I think part of it was they had the photographs of the girl, and she was really pretty. And it was and Christmas was involved, right? The thing with that woman who died a few years back, Lacey Peterson, was disappearing on Christmas. So there's like the Christmas angle. If somebody dies on Christmas...
I mean, the creepy child beauty pageant thing.
But, you know, that was all very weird because if the parents didn't do it, then it really doesn't have anything to do with beauty pageants. The beauty pageants are just something that you might think are tacky or stupid or you think are, you know, too sexualizing of children or something like that. But really, I mean, it seems to me children have dressed up and pretended to be adults. It's like an old thing that children always do. And to try to make it into some special evil thing that's connected to
murder. It's pretty creepy. Did you see Little Miss Sunshine?
No.
Well, you're rich.
Okay. Well, I'd be more informed if I had.
There's a creepy beauty pageant involved.
Well, you know, some people do pageants, and I think some of looking down on pageants is a little bit sort of classist or snobbish, you know? It's like something that some people do and get into. And if you have a sort of a, you know, contemptuous attitude about it, you can make a movie about it and make the people look bad, but, you know, maybe a sympathetic view from the inside would seem quite different. And what's wrong
possibly.
With children pretending to be adults? Why isn't it considered creepy to give a little girl a doll, a baby doll, you know, and act as if she had had a baby? Why isn't that
wrong? I never thought about it, but that actually is kind of creepy.
Yeah. I mean, and why are you encouraging little girls to have babies? That's just inviting them into the world of sex and implying that they've had sex because they have a baby. So why aren't we creeped out by that?
Now I'm creeped out.
Okay, well, let me bring up another subject relating to child abuse.
Oh, sure. This is pretty creepy, too.
This is the subject of a school in Queens, in New York, where they have the children spending the entire school day, I think a really long school day, like 10 hours or so?
9 hours, memorizing the Quran.
And all they do is memorize the Quran, and they don't even learn Arabic. They learn it in Arabic just as a series of sounds.
Right, they learn the chant.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I should say, you know, every once in a while I hear people, obviously it's not the same as this, but expressing sentiment that it's bizarre that in Muslim schools in non-Arab countries, they will, you know, in Pakistan and Indonesia, they will teach the kids to chant the Quran in Arabic, mm-hmm. but not actually teach them Arabic. But, that was how I studied for my bar mitzvah.
Yeah, but you also went to school, and you didn't just...
No. Sure. I mean, it's not the same as doing no school at all. No. I just mean that the learning by chanting thing is, like, standard in religions
that make you speak a foreign
language.
Right, and obviously there's some religions where you just chant for the purpose of going into a sort of a trance, right?
Right.
Entering a religious state, but you might do that by chanting, right? You might have a mantra or something like that. So the idea of chanting words that aren't inherently meaningful to you might have a religious value that's not unique.
Right.
But my problem
obviously
is just
the problem here is that they're not getting a real education.
And also that
side.
It's not being taken seriously, that they're not following the laws about compulsory education, if a Christian school, for example, was only teaching, if people took their kids out of public school, sent them to Christian school, or kept them home for homeschool, and then only taught religion, even in English, that would not be accepted at all, and I think they would very quickly get into trouble. And the idea of just placating this group by allowing it to be different, and different to the point of abusing children, and not...
I mean, it shouldn't be allowed. I mean, I wonder, though, I mean, how highly supervised are, you know, homeschooled people, really? And I mean, I noticed that, I mean, conservatives and libertarians mm-hmm. seem to me to be constantly pressing for less and less oversight of homeschooling, of religious schools. Mm-hmm. And the reason they do that is that what they have in mind, I mean, conservatives especially, is that what they have in mind is that religious schooling is going to mean Christian schooling.
Right.
And so efforts to prevent the schooling from being crazy and abusive are going to be liberal efforts to, you know, water down the Christianity. But obviously there are Muslims in America, and I think the situation, you know, looks different to your standard issue,
I think
Republican.
I teach a course in religion and the Constitution. There are a lot mm-hmm. of issues about which, if you think about it as your religion being the one that gets the freedom, you're very eager to get it, but if you're forced to think of a hypothetical with some other religion getting the same, like introducing it into the public school classroom or something like that, then or doing something in prison, then you suddenly see it a different way. I just think it should be the same across the board, and I feel like this school is being given a special privilege, and a special privilege to abuse, not just to not teach them academic subjects, but to really just take their minds and deprive them of the chance to develop independent thinking.
Yes. No. I mean, having people chant the Quran all day is not that hot. You shouldn't let people do it. But I just do think, you know, people should consider, like, if we have, you know, vouchers, some of them are going to go mm-hmm. to madrasas. And now, probably, you know, to things that are less extreme.
Well, one reason for having vouchers and things like that is it gives government an entree to, you know, then impose regular, like, you get the money if you meet all of these standards.
Sure.
Get to go in there and start imposing the standards, and it really is a way to get people to assimilate and to dilute what makes them different. Now, if you think it's important for people to be able to preserve their difference, you might say, well, that's a bad thing that government gets to come in and impose all of those limits.
Right. No, but like, I mean, it should be good. I mean, I think, you know, if anything, precisely because the people in schools are children, right? Mm-hmm. You know, the question of like freedom and people should be allowed to do what they want, and, you know, in some ways doesn't enter into it, because mm-hmm. What you have here, right, is that the kids' parents, sure, are freely choosing to send their kids to this school, but then what's happening is that the kids are basically being, you know, controlled all the time, and they deserve
And we
you
don't
know,
normally
better than that.
Well, there's a lot of questions about how much you're going to let parents make decisions about children. I mean, obviously, parents could do horrible things to their children. And how much should the government, prevent them from doing that? I got a lot of sort of libertarian types when I wrote about this on my blog. I got a lot of libertarian types saying they objected to the whole idea of compulsory schooling. And basically thought people should be able to do what they want, either educate their kids or not.
I think that's
school.
Fine if you're crazy.
although the
one thing I do think has to be kept in mind when you think about regulating these things is that, and while this is such an extreme case that you can almost certainly do it, but that you don't want to regulate so tightly that committed religious parents just decide that what they need to do is sort of try and keep their kids off the books and not bring them into the system at all where people know about them, because things can get worse. And I mean, I know in Europe there have been some problems along those lines where when you try to crack down on abusive religious practices and you wind up just completely losing sight of the children.
Right.
So there is some reason for the authorities to tread cautiously here, but I mean, if the kids are really not learning anything other than the chance, I don't see how you can let them do that.
Hey, let me ask you one more question. I have one more question I thought
All right.
of, and that is, let's talk about Joe Lieberman. Is he sort of like basically the Republican candidate now?
I never thought this was going to work for him running as an independent, but what I hadn't considered was the chance that the Republican candidate could do so badly in the polls that Lieberman is now a bit ahead of Ned Lamont, and the Republican candidate is getting almost nobody's support in the polls. And so
he just happened to luck into the fact that Schlesinger is just a terrible candidate. So he's just kind of become the Republican candidate.
Right, but this also shows, though, liberals are a little dim-witted, I think, because, still, if you could get some money together...
Liberals are a little dim-witted. You must elaborate.
Right. See, I mean, what you need to do is get some liberal money together, and instead of giving it to Ned Lamont, give it to Schlesinger, so that he can run ads about how Joe Lieberman supports partial birth abortion and wants to hand control of our economy over to the Kyoto Protocol, blah, 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 and get those Schlesinger numbers back up to, they don't need to be good, but if he gets as much as 15%, Lieberman's doomed.
But doesn't that always work out badly when one side actually starts supporting the spoiler and... He's the Republican Party candidate, but he's in the traditional role of a third-party spoiler.
Right. But, I think it works fine. And, you just got to be... Politics is a... You need to be a little cunning.
Yeah, but part of the politics, if you do something too cunning and people find out, then they'll be exposed and you'll look bad doing that. So it's sort of like dirty tricks, isn't it?
Yeah, I feel like dirty tricks usually work.
Isn't it public knowledge who makes all these contributions? I mean, wouldn't it
well,
just
it's
be
public knowledge, but there's a delay in when it's disclosed.
So is that what you're recommending, really?
You file these reports. Yeah.
So you're recommending that liberals give money to Schlesinger?
Yes. That's what I'm recommending. I tell you here and now, if you want to see Ned Lamont in the Senate, that you give money to Schlesinger. He's the best chance. It's weird because national Republicans have, not endorsed Schlesinger, are all talking up Lieberman, and some people think that Lieberman's, that what's going to happen is Lieberman will win, get the seat, then Bush will appoint him to something, and then the Republican governor of Connecticut will get to appoint Lieberman's replacement. So that's a big liberal conspiracy theory.
Well, they should publicize that. That might influence some people.
It sounds plausible, too, at least a little.
Yeah, and if the balance of power in the Senate is close, getting the Republican in, well, that's interesting. I think that's a strong point. They should use that.
Right. Yes.
Well, I noticed that Lieberman today or yesterday was, really becoming much stronger in supporting the war and so forth, that he was beginning to articulate his positions in a more, going on the offense kind of a way, and then he's sort of repositioning himself and, really sort of running with it, becoming the Republican candidate.
Yes. No. And it's sort of frightening to think, from my perspective, what will become of him if he wins.
But don't you think if he wins that they'll all just welcome him back into the fold and they'll just do what's in their interest?
Maybe. I mean, it's just really since he really has functionally become the Republican candidate in the race, mm-hmm. I mean, most of his votes are going to be from Republicans. We don't know, you know, exactly who's been getting his money yet since mm-hmm. the disclosures haven't come out. But, you know, I mean, to some extent, you have to dance with the ones that brung you, right? I mean...
Yeah, but if he wins and goes back, don't you think they'll want to embrace him and they'll all be old pals again like they have been for the last 18 years? Why would they act like, oh, now they don't like him? They've been working with him for 18 years. Why would they?
Right.
I just can't picture
him.
No,
I don't know. It'll be touchy because, you know, from Lieberman's perspective, he will say that all the Democrats who endorsed him in the primary mm-hmm. but then didn't endorse him in the general election... stabbed him in the back.
Oh, I think he can say, you know, that it's all understood that we have a party, there's a certain way we behave, mm-hmm. and there's a primary and somebody wins it, and the right thing to do, if that's your party, is to then endorse that candidate. And so they did what was the ordinary thing to do within the party, but it wasn't personal against Joe.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well,
and so if Joe wins, then they'll welcome him back. Don't you think that
would work out? Like that. I'm not that optimistic, though, about how he'll relate to other Democrats if he wins. I mean, for a while, his lead was looking pretty solid. I think mm-hmm. the two most recent polls I've seen see it narrowing.
Yeah, but I think what I saw in one of the polls was that the undecideds were completely not for Lamont. They weren't undecided between Lieberman and Lamont. They were undecided between Lieberman and the Republicans.
Huh.
So yeah, the undecided category has no potential for Lamont, apparently.
I should pay more attention.
That might not be. I saw one thing like that. Obviously, we're following these polls all the time.
Right. Should we wrap it up?
Do you think that's is that a Blogging Heads episode? Do you think? I hope
we can
patch together the crazy gap and the 18-minute gap.
I hope so.
Okay. Well, it was fun talking to you.